Now let's take a look at some stereo vision systems in nature. This is often referred to as stereopsis. Stereo is Greek for solid, and opsis is Greek for appearance. So that's where the term stereopsis comes from. And it's really interesting. Stereopsis actually manifests in many different ways in different animals. It turns out that in the case of predators, often the two views, the two eyes, actually overlap in terms of field of view quite substantially. And the reason is you want the overlap in the fields of view to be able to do stereo and then depth perception. And predators are not only looking for prey, but they also want to know exactly where they are in terms of depth so that they can strategize their next move. In contrast, when you look at preys, very often, although they have two eyes in all of these cases, very often these two eyes don't overlap in terms of their fields of view substantially. The two eyes are being used to generate a wider field of view for them to be able to see more of the world so that they can detect predators who are on the hunt. So different purposes that the two eyes are being used for by preys and predators, but there's more depth perception that seems to be happening in the case of predators. And if you look at the human vision system and its stereo system, it's really fascinating. It's a beautiful creation. Here you have your two eyes. The interocular distance, or the distance between the two eyes for adults, is on average about 64 millimeters. And as you know, when you look at something, both your eyes have to verge on that thing. They have to actually have their optical axes converge at that point. That's how you're going to end up projecting that object onto the foveas of the two eyes. That's called vergence. And that's made possible by a very sophisticated, let's call it servo control system, which uses six muscles. These are called ocular muscles in each of the two eyes. Very sophisticated system. And the two images that I captured, we want these to be processed for depth perception. That is, you're doing stereo matching. And in this case, we know that the visual cortex is distributed over both sides of the brain in the back right here. So the question is, where do we end up doing, how do we exploit both sides to do the computations needed for stereo matching? So the way our system does this is that you have an image, say, formed in the left eye right here, an image in the right eye. We know that an object that lands on the right side of the left eye probably also lands on the right side of the right eye. And therefore, the right sides of the two images, the right halves of the two images, go through the lateral geniculate nucleus right here and are sent to the same side of the brain. The left sides of the two images are sent to the same sides of the brain so that things like stereo matching can be done in the same place. Otherwise, you would need to have connections between the two sides of the brain in order to be able to exchange information that's needed to do the matching. So that's how that works. Very interesting how these things have evolved over time. And lots of experiments have been done in the context of depth perception, and many different contraptions have been used to understand how stereo vision works in the case of humans. So here is one such contraption, which is called the pseudoscope. In this case, what's happening here is that you have a set of mirrors that reflect light from the object such that the ray of light that should have gone in from the object into the right eye ends up being redirected into the left eye, and the opposite is true for the one that is supposed to have gone to the left eye, that ends up being directed to the right eye. So you're flipping, it's a little bit like taking the images that are being formed on your retina, left and right, and simply swapping them. And this leads to interesting effects such as depth reversal. Convex objects under certain circumstances end up appearing concave and so on. Other experiments have used things like the telestereoscope. In this case, what is being done is to, again, use mirrors to redirect light so that the effective distance, interocular distance between the two eyes can be adjusted. So in this case, using this particular contraption, these eyes receive images like as if they were further apart from each other than they really are. That has the effect of making the world appear small or large. An object of a certain size may end up appearing much smaller or much bigger based on how this is redirected. And then there's this very interesting experiment that was done by Pulfrich. It's called the Pulfrich pendulum effect. So in this case, you have, again, your stereo system. You can actually try this out. But in front of one of your eyes, say the left eye shown here, you place sunshades, very dark sunshades. The other one doesn't have a shade on top of it. And then in front of you, there is this pendulum where a ball goes back and forth along a line. This is the actual path of the pendulum right here. But since you have dark glasses or a dark glass in front of the left eye, it turns out that the left eye produces an image because of the darkness. It produces an image of an object with a little bit of a delay so that the image of this object when it was here is actually produced at a time by which this object has moved to this new location and is already being perceived by the right eye. So when the right eye sees the image as being here, that's when this image of the left eye is produced. And therefore, if you then triangulate using those two images, you perceive the object as being in this location, the ball as being in this location. So as the pendulum moves back and forth, although it's moving along a straight line, you get the perception that it's actually moving along an ellipse in 3D. Very interesting. And then this is a fascinating set of experiments done by G.M. Stratton. Very interesting set of experiments, given that they were done back in 1896 or so. His interest was in trying to understand what happens to our visual perception if we shifted the images in the eye or even inverted the image. In fact, he is the first human to have experienced upright images of the world. Remember that images falling on our retina are actually inverted. We know this. But he managed to use mirrors and lenses to flip the image and see what would be for us upside down images of the world, and wore these contraptions over days to see if he could get used to seeing the world that way and functioning in the world. There's a lot of experiments that Stratton has done, which is clearly way ahead of his time. And this particular experiment that I'm showing you here, he has this contraption that he wore for about 3 days. And whenever he did these experiments, when he was awake, he ensured that he always saw the world only through the contraption. And it was only at nighttime when he went to sleep that he would take the contraption off, but immediately put blinders on to make sure that he stayed in that world, the world seen through the contraption. So in this case, he had this contraption that made him look at himself from up above. So what he ended up seeing was a view of himself, like as if he was floating in space right here. He said in his notes that he had essentially an out-of-body experience. He was looking at the world from outside his body. He wore this for 3 days. He tried to teach himself to handle various objects, to tie his shoelaces, to function on a daily basis. And what he realized was that with time, although not easy, he was able to slowly get used to seeing the world through this contraption, this very unusual perspective. And on day 3 or so, he talks about how he actually went out for a walk and was able to, for the first time, appreciate the beauty of the world, because until that point he was struggling with getting used to this this new view of the world. But what was most interesting about his experiments is that he reported that when he stopped wearing the contraption, he very quickly came back to his the sort of visual world that he was used to. So his ability to adjust back to the normal vision was very quick, but also demonstrated that the human visual system, as well as monkeys, have the ability to actually adapt to these shifted and inverted images to a certain extent. But this, unfortunately, is not true for other animals. So here's a Pfister's hen, and in this case, a lot of experiments were done using prisms in front of the eyes of these animals, the hen in this particular case, to rotate their field of view by, say, 7 degrees or 10 degrees or 15 degrees. Many different experiments have been done here. And when you do this, obviously, the hen is, when it's especially trying to feed itself and it's trying to peck on a grain, it ends up pecking in the wrong place. And what's fascinating is that while humans and monkeys are able to adapt to shifted and even inverted images, it turns out that lesser animals, such as the hen in this case, is simply not able to do it. And even after months, they're not able to adapt to this new vision and end up starving to death, unfortunately. And finally, here's a fascinating experiment by Held and Hain. This one relates to whether we need to interact physically with the world in order to learn to see. So here there are two kittens that were brought up in darkness initially, and then they were placed in this contraption. There are two baskets that you can see here. And one of them, one of the two kittens, is allowed to make contact with the ground. The other one sits in the basket and does not make contact with the ground. The one that does make contact with the ground is able to move around and thereby is able to spin this contraption around. The other one is a passive observer. This one is an active observer. So the interesting thing about this experiment and what makes it ingenious is that whatever it is that is the left kitten is doing, both kittens essentially see the same world. They receive the same visual stimulus. So they see exactly the same thing. This goes on for a long time. And what they found is that the one that was able to move and actually make contact with the ground, the active observer, so to speak, ended up developing vision after some time and being able to navigate and walk around. Whereas the passive observer, the one on the right, remains more or less blind for all practical purposes. So this was used as evidence that in order to develop visual perception, you also need to be an active learner. You need to interact with the world that you live in. That's the hypothesis here.